The city already had a water system. They already had a water supply and customers. And the authority, and with the assistance of the Board of Commissioners, was going to develop the system. And that existed for about 10 years. The oldest document that I found, that you kind of see that there was some conflicts many years ago, was a letter from the engineer to the county commission and the chairman of the authority, and had found that the city was going to be requesting water for the whole county and parts of Cherokee County. And obviously, there was some concern about that. And my PowerPoint is not working properly. The fly-ins are not working.
Right. Give me a slideshow.
Okay. There we go. Thanks for the help. I'm not much on PowerPoint, so this is a little tough week. And that's why it doesn't look very good either. So that was discovered, I think. This was a notification given by the Water and Sewerage Authority on a city project. And they commented there that they were concerned that the city at that time didn't have any plans for sewer. They were asking that, one thing here, the city was requesting insistence on some territorial agreements before they can move forward with their purchase of water. This was a letter written to the district engineer, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. I believe this was in 1977. Again, it was on the withdrawal from a lake or from the city, about a 10 million gallon a day withdrawal permit. And the comments were generally in support, but they requested that 7 million of that be reserved for the future need of the Cumming and Forsyth County Water Authority, until they could decide how things were going to be done. So the allocation was basically for both the city service area and outside. Apparently there were disagreements that started with the authority right away about line extensions between the authority and the city. This is a letter the city, there are times of peace and there are times when they weren't agreeing too much through the history. They reached out to each other in order to purchase water, and they believed that through mutual cooperation, the two governments could provide the best service, and an offer was made to the authority to purchase water at a rate of 70 cents per thousand. At that present time, the authority was purchasing water from Fulton County, and several lines in South Forsyth had been extended up into the county. Attached with that document is an engineer's report to the mayor from their engineer on the rate study, and he's talking a little bit there about the purchase prices and the promise of doing it for both and the help for both. But basically, there's a real important thing in here as far as water rates go, and this is what their engineer said: the majority of the cost to produce the water fixed costs and not related to water usage, and a 10% increase in water production will result in a 7% decrease in the cost of the water production. And then later in the memo, it's recommended that 70 cents per thousand usage and could therefore be offered on a long-term basis. Shortly after that, the authority ran into financial trouble. They either didn't have the water agreements, couldn't make it work. They abolished, folks were deciding to abolish the authority and were going to turn it over to the county. The city had some concern and opposition about that and wondered why it was not being given to the city since they had the plant. And the answer was the authority hadn't. The city representatives hadn't been to the authority meeting, and the county had provided office space and other things, and they felt like the county had the total county as well in mind best. After this happened, after the county got access to the system, they started requesting withdrawal permits and the ability to build their own plant. They found the city had requested for an expansion that was for the entire county, and so they had not seen that. They sent a letter to the EPD. The DNR, the EPD, sent a letter back to the city stating that the county was unaware of the study and the plans to provide water countywide. and that they intended to allow the county to go ahead with development of an independent water system consistent with EPD requirements. Shortly after this, city and county got together again. An agreement was reached to purchase wholesale water from the city as being the best source. Their initial rate was 0.985 cents per thousand gallons, and that rate included a wheeling fee, or the cost to distribute the water out to us, the pumping cost, the piping cost, storage costs. So that was included in the base rate. This is a letter to the EPD director from the county, and again, they're working together with city and county to implement the water system. They are requesting that the permit to the city be issued from the lake for the purpose of serving. Well, they're asking that it not be issued without written concurrence from the county. They wanted to make sure they had that was for county customers also. Their comment there was their interpretation of the allocation is that it's our water, just happens to be going through Cumming's intake. This is a letter from the DNR to city manager, and it's about the request for withdrawal. And in the letter at the bottom, they suggest that the city and the county designate one office to conduct future correspondence. The city and county both were asking for the same thing. The EPD said, look, just one of you send the letters from now on, and we'll keep you informed. And so there was a joint cooperation and moving forward at this time. This was 1988. Shortly after this, the city was advised of the costs for storage of water in the Lake Lanier from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. They have a storage allocation contractor. They were currently negotiating it here. And they got notice of $200,000 a year additional cost. City of Cumming, in their June 24th, 1990 minutes, took that into consideration, the need for $200,000 additional money. And they voted, since Tyson's and Forsyth County used over 50% of the water, that they should bear the appropriate cost. And rates were increased from $1.24 to $1.75, and then you see the increases there in the city. There's probably different ratios because of the amounts of water. I don't know exactly how that was done.
Is this finished water?
This is finished, all finished water. Everything I'm talking about is finished water. We'll get to the raw water at the very end, but it's all finished. Finished water is treated water through the City of Cumming's plant. They have a plant on Highway 9 just north of town. And then since 2000, we have a plant out off of Antioch Road that we get raw water through the city's intake to treat. And then we buy both finished water from the city and then get raw water permitted to us through their intake on a partnership deal, and then we treat that. So the rates were probably different here because of the amount of water each one of these people were using. I'm not sure it should have carried on for $200,000 as the volumes went up. There may have been or should have been adjustment. I don't know if that happened. I don't even know if these rates got dropped after this. They didn't stay at $1.75. I've got a board up out front. You'll see a couple of spikes where the rates, this was one of them, the rate was disputed. This rate was dropped back down for a period of time. There's a couple of occasions that through negotiations or review of the rate increase that the city dropped the rates back down. This $1.75 increase was one of those that retroactively got adjusted. This is a letter then, the next time we had a rate issue disagreement was in 1993. The county again was stating that they felt like they had already purchased capacity in the facility and the intake through various sources, and that they had no, this is important, that they had no problem with the city's planned expansion, but they wanted to make sure that there was no financial obligation perceived in the city's move ahead because the counties were planning on doing their own plan. This is a letter in 1995 to the county manager with a proposed rate increase from $1.45. which had gotten reduced back down from the earlier rate increase I talked about, up to $2.01 per 1,000 gallons. It's a notice from the city on that. It's a letter back to the city from Chairman Ron Cedar at the time. After much consideration, they respectfully disagreed with the calculations until the correct calculations determined in accordance with the agreement. This is a letter back from the city, getting a little more concerned about the water supply, and gave a deadline to pay. I believe at this time the county had to enter an injunction, and we started a court hearing over establishment of these rates shortly after this. I became the director a few months after this, almost before my time. In 1995, the county hired Ernst & Young to do a rate study based on the contract, and they determined that the rate, according to the contract, should have gone to $1.44 per 1,000 gallons, going back to 1986, using the method. Of course, all this was, I'm sure, disputed. This is a letter to Harold Rehas from the city of Cumming. That started a battle with the county and the city over our own plant. And until that got resolved, everybody was flexing their muscle, obviously. And this was a letter that the city wrote requesting that the EPD not issue us a permit to withdraw from the lake or treat our own water. And they were concerned about the bondholders and the ability to pay off the bond that they had borrowed earlier. And after that, the city and the county, a little later, reached agreement in 98. The disputes on the rate was dropped, and the challenge against building our own plant was dropped, and we established a rate. This is just briefly some of the key permitting history. A lot of people wonder how much effort the county has spent in trying to get withdrawals. The very first permit that we did get was in 1995. We got that permit in 1996. As soon as we built our new plant in 2000, the chairman of the commissioners, I believe he's sitting here tonight, told us it's not too early to start planning the next expansion, go ask for more water. So we asked for more water in 2000. By this time, the water wars is getting heated up pretty heavily. We've had many meetings with EPD. We had to work through a lot of question answers about justifying the demand through this time frame. A few years ago, when Magnuson ruling came out and said the lake withdrawals drawers have to get out, that those were all illegal, we were told to find water wherever we could. We looked for sources far and wide, wherever we could find them, any option we could come up with. The EPD encouraged us to look at a river withdrawal. It was encouraging. We had meetings with them. We provided the documents, made the applications, because the river is the waters of the state. The federal reservoir is Lake Lanier. That's where the federal government has control. They have to have a storage contract. Once they release that water from you for dam, it's waters of the state. Now the state decides who gets it. And you have to justify the need. They don't just give you the permit because you can take it. We went down in January of 2010 expecting to pick up the withdrawal permit for only part of the water. We never wanted to take all of it. We just wanted to get our additional increase from what we're getting today out of the river to handle our expansions going forward. And we found that Forsyth County had been used in an appeal to the 11th Circuit as a need to appeal Magnuson's ruling. And that got held up, and I'll get into that again a little later. I've got more documents to show some of the stuff that we have done. Here's a copy of the withdrawal permit that we finally did get back in 1996. However, we couldn't get the Corps to give us an easement to build an intake, so we had to go back and work the deal out with the city to get the water through their existing intake. And that's how our permit got rewritten. A lot of people don't think we've got a permit. Our permit got rewritten to pull our water through their intake because of this agreement. This is the agreement where we settled our differences and agreed to the contracts that are about to expire. Letters from the EPD talking about the county and city being on their way to reach an agreement. and how we could take the water through the city's intake. This is, and I'll just buzz through this, this is our agreement that we have for raw water today on sharing the cost of that. It's a partnership. We paid capital money in to use that, $4.8 million. It's truly a partnership. We pay proportionate share for whatever it costs, power, electricity, maintenance. If a pump breaks down based on our 12-month proportional use, we split the bill. So there's no markup, there's no risk on their part to need to mark it up because we're responsible for replacement under the contract. And it's worked very, very well for us. It is the city intake. There is one section in there that comes in question that talks about expansion and replacement of capital expansion, and it just says that it has to have prior written approval of the Board of Commissioners. This is a city permit that was revised at the same time the counties was revised to combine the withdrawals. And in it, the city had requested that there be language that said there wouldn't be a permit violation until the combined two withdrawals exceeded 37 million gallons. They have a permit for 21 million gallons. We have a permit for 16 million gallons to provide flexibility. Requested language was that they add that in. The EPD didn't word it exactly. They just said at no time can the combined withdrawals from the two plants exceed 37 million gallons a day. That's our peak day max. We're still working on the core during this time. We are trying to get them to release us into the lake at risk any way we can. This is a copy of a comment back, that a letter from someone with the Undersecretary of the Army, I believe, or the Corps of Engineers, I'm not sure, talking about the current expired contracts, and that they weren't even renewing the existing contracts, and they couldn't allow anybody into the lake for any purpose of getting additional water. They wouldn't even let us run a bigger pipe down Pilgrim Mill Road because it might have led to additional water. We needed to cross the lake, and we had to spend $200,000 to take the cover apart to put the pipe on the right of way because the Corps wouldn't let us move 10 feet over onto an easement. That's how serious they were about not doing anything. They had a federal judge that had an injunction against them at that time. History of the rates, this is what the board was put together from. These slides, unfortunately, are in landscape mode, and they're going to get mashed together. Hopefully you can see them a little bit. It's the same thing up front. In PowerPoint, unfortunately, you can't switch aspects between two different types of slides. This is the cost showing economies of scale since 2000. This does not include depreciation. Depreciation's money you put back for replacement, other things are for budgets, but this is just the cost to produce the water. So you'll see as that earlier slide, as the volume goes up, doesn't necessarily mean your cost is going to go up. Most of it's labor. So our cost at our plant to actually treat our own water has dropped. It'll level out shortly after this. The spike you see in 2008 was the time when the watering restrictions were put on and we didn't get to sell much water that year, but our fixed cost stayed the same. So that's what happened there. These slides you obviously won't be able to read. I was asked to touch on I've got to blow up on one of those later. Touch on some spreadsheets we created just to see what the cost to purchase water is versus finishing it ourselves. Showing you our needs. This graph depicts our history and our projected growth. Now keep in mind that you always want to be above these numbers. You don't want to be below these spikes going forward. This is our current permit. This is a 30-day average. This red line is, these are the max day numbers that our system has had. You'll see this year we had a max day of around 21 million gallons a day that we used. We can only do 16 million gallons a day. We had to purchase that water from somebody, get it somewhere. This is along with what we can get from the city. I've got a slide later. In 1999, we agreed to continue to purchase a set amount of water from them, and it follows monthly patterns. And so we're able to get about 7 million gallons a day from the city in the summertime, 7.5, sometimes more. We work together very well to help each other out. And then we can get 2 million gallons a day for an average month from the city. And this also shows when our the physical capacity, when our plant comes online in a couple of months, we would add this physical capacity out here, and then we project what our next plant expansion is going to be. This just shows you 2011. 2011 was not an extremely dry year. This is the curve. These are the plot of the daily with amounts. This is a 30-day average. We also have a permit that says we can't exceed a certain amount in a 30-day monthly average. So that's a plot of this. That limit for us is 14 million gallons a day. So where we're above 14 million gallons a day, we could not finish that water under our current permit without it being expanded. These are some past projections we did to show when we're going to have to do the expansion, similar to the earlier graph. These are the amounts in 1999 we bought from the city. And so these are what we try to target for each month as we're doing those purchases, but we do have flexibility there. Slide you couldn't see earlier as far as savings, because we've built everything, our depreciation's there, all the other things except the permit, it's not going to cost a lot of money to treat it ourselves. This is a summary of that spreadsheet that's been presented, and it's got the savings. This is sort of a checkbook that we could have for being able to treat our own water. And that's why as soon as possible, we want to treat our own water. This is a copy of a letter that was asked to put up in 2010 that was sent to the city with some proposals to renew both the raw water agreement and the finished water agreement. This is a letter from the Army Corps of Engineers I mentioned earlier that they wouldn't let us cross Pilgrim Mill Road. This was denial of that easement. And they pointed out the concern for any additional water because of the expired contracts. And at that time, the Water Wars case was a little different than it is today. This is some language that was used. I told you we were denied a river withdrawal. The EPD director, when Magnuson issued his ruling, said that it was not approvable, and that any withdrawals out of the lake, except for two, were not properly approved and had to get out. And so the state of Georgia needed a reason to appeal that. So they had to show there was harm being done. They had to show there was an urgent need to appeal it. So unfortunately, for Scythe County, having shown a need for the water and a permit in hand the 1st of January or whenever we found out they had used us as that need. And so these are excerpts from the affidavit that was submitted to the court. The EPD director said until this gets resolved, until either the Court of Appeals says no, you can't appeal it, or it gets reversed, I can't issue a permit. So we really haven't done a whole lot until recently with the EPD on additional water, because this pretty much at this time slammed the door on us. And so that's why we've been looking for groundwater and anything else. Some recent changes. In July of 2009, I mentioned Magnuson's ruling. There in January 21st, shortly after we got notice, the appeals court allowed an appeal of Magnuson. In June of 2011, the appeals court overturned the Magnuson ruling and said he messed up and water supply should be allowed in Lake Lanier. And so the impediment that was justified and the reason has been lifted. I'm sure there's still lots of concerns on the state. They're trying to resolve this year. But one thing that has happened, and I've confirmed this with the Public Works Director's Office in Roswell, is they have received, even though in the earlier letter she said she had placed a hold on all permits for expanded water in the basin, in the Chattahoochee Basin, Roswell has received a surface water withdrawal permit for a small amount of water, which is, and they claim they argued the same issue with them. So hopefully things are opening up there a little bit. That's not necessarily our best choice. This is just a news clip when they allowed the appeal. Here's a news clip. Couldn't find an actual permit yet, but there's a news clip where Ross was planning to build an expansion a little bit to their plant. The last thing that I was asked to show was the invoice for the raw water intake from the city of Cumming, and our share is $11,436,450 per this invoice. And buzz through that as fast as I could. Yep.
The source, last week you said Bob was approved?
Yes.
What was the source?
It's out of Big Creek.
It's out of Big Creek?
Yes. But it's the basin, the impediment was in the whole basin, so Big Creek flows into Chattahoochee. It's a surface water withdrawal, and that's what was put on hold. They also got a, you might hear that, I believe they also got a groundwater permit, so there could be some, they've gotten both. But they did say surface water, and they told me the reason they fought for 18 or 19 months to get it, and the reason they were denied was this same language for a long time, and they were successful getting past that.
Yeah.
Yes?
The earlier slide, we share the operation cost, but not the capital agreement, the capital expansion. The invoice we showed, the new water in.
I believe that's been the interpretation of county attorney that would be a capital expansion and needed written approval. But the county obviously knew it. The city did us a favor by building it. A few months earlier, we had a letter that said nobody was going to do anything. This was before the lake got down and got serious. And they had the temporary barge out there. If it hadn't been for that, Corps would have probably never let them build that new intake, and it was reaching its maximum capacity. So we're fortunate it got built, but at the same time, there's no promise for additional water. It was at risk. Still no promise for additional water. And so the county knew, but the city didn't, to my knowledge, come and ask for a written approval with the cost estimates or anything. And I believe that's a capital expansion.
The shared allocation between the city and the town is $37 million.
$37 million. That's the max day,
and that is assigned by EPD.
EPD. Each permit has an amount. So when you say shared, there's documentation of being together. But obviously, when they issue permits, they need a set amount in each permit.
Right.
So we've got an amount. They've got an amount, and there's similar language on both permits that I showed. Absolutely.
So the language that's in the invoice that was sent by the city says that the mayor could give us 65%. Capacity of the intake really is meaningless because the mayor doesn't have the power to change the allocation of the water between the city and county.
Correct. If memory serves, the 65% is the Metropolitan North Georgia Water Planning District is a regional group that deals with water issues in the area, and our future expected water demands for both the city and county are part of that. And that 65% is the percent of the future need. And so you're right, the Corps of Engineers and EPD still has to give those allocations. All that was, we talked about getting 65% of whatever ends up being available.
Right.
We don't know if we'll get all the water we want out of lake. We don't know if we'll get any more. And so.
It's not American spread.
Right. The allocation, the amount of water we're going to be able to get is totally EPD and then the Corps on whether or not it's available in the lake.
The separation, however, our agreement between the county and the city is less than we can. In other words, if they give us 37 million gallons, we can negotiate 2116 or we can negotiate 1691.
Well, the EPD is going to issue them out. I think. If I'm answering the question right, you can purchase a percent ownership or percent interest in something, and that's what's being proposed.
What I'm saying is if our maximum, and I have another question for our maximum, how are we going to get about says that the maximum we can withdraw is 37 million gallons a day. Is that per day, or you mentioned the average over 30?
That's your max day. You got two numbers in most permits. You got a max day that says this is the most you can pull out on any given day. And then to control that further, they look at 30-day averages. Our 30-day average is 14. Right. Cities is 18 million gallons a day.
Mayor made a statement earlier today that it's not one of these small meetings, that county representatives are to share.
Excuse me, we really can't hear anybody. What? This is really important.
Yeah, what are we going to do about questions?
Why don't we do this? Why don't you, if you have a question, let's go ahead and implement. If you have a question, please come to the front row and have a seat, and then as your question comes up, come up here and use this mic so everybody can hear the question. Why don't we start with you, Jeff?
Okay. The mayor today had a press conference. Can you hear that? Had a town hall meeting, and he mentioned he brought up the billing, that invoice that the county had gotten back in January. It was due in 30 days that we paid $5 on for some $14 million or whatever. And he stated at that time that should we pay that, and the wording in that states that if we pay that, then we will deserve two-thirds of that allocation. We pay two-thirds, 66 or 65% of that bill, and then we will deserve 66% of that allocation. And then he went on to state that means that, and he kept referring to the intake infrastructure as being its capacity at 100 million gallons a day, and that Forsyth County could draw 66 million gallons a day. If our allocation were 37 million gallons a day, what's the maximum capacity that we could draw per day?
66% of 37 million, is that what you're asking?
Right, I'm trying to verify the veracity of the mayor's statement today. He said that if we paid that two-thirds share of that infrastructure improvement, not necessarily capital, as they ignored that, that we would then deserve two-thirds, and then he went on to describe that two-thirds share as being 66% of that 105 or 100 million gallon a day capacity. We can't draw. I mean, that was my question. Is it, as long as we don't draw more than 37 million or whatever our share of the allocation is, we can draw 190 gallons that day, as long as we don't average more than our share. There's a certain percentage of it. And then once again, to clarify what Hal had said, and then what I said. There you go. If we had an allocation, let's just use raw numbers. If we had a 40 million gallon a day allocation, and the city of Cumming got 20 of that, and or let's say they got 15 and we got 25, or can we flip that and them get 25 and us get 15? In other words, once CPD issues an allocation for our shared thing, can we then negotiate the difference in how we split that up?
That you're getting into just legal documents and negotiation. I just want to be in the detail of all that. So I mean, what you actually get in the contract, I really couldn't comment on that. But we can negotiate a potential share in what the structure that the city's built. It's physically able to do in a certain amount of water, and they're willing to let us share and purchasing into that structure in some way.
Right, the question is of the authority, though. That our division of that shared allocation, let's say the shared allocation is 50 million gallons a day, and they're getting 30, and we're getting 20, but we're two-thirds, and they're one-third, and so once,
yes.
So is that negotiation of how that share occurs between us and them, or what influence does EPD have with that share?
It's decided by the EPD.
Okay.
Al?
Yes.
You had a graph up there that showed the average consumption. It was the graph that showed that we used, 8 million a day for most of the year, and then it peaked up to, I think you said 21 million at one point. That graph.
That's the 30 day average.
Yeah, this graph right here, correct. So if you look at that graph, our current capability is to finish.
It's right here. We keep everything above that 14 MGD is above.
So everything, the, only that part of the graph that's above the 14 million gallons a day is where the county actually has to purchase water in order to service its customers, right?
Correct.
And do you know what time period that is?
These starts in January. This is, you know.
So it's probably like from.
It's like June, July.
I mean, just a guess.
You see, we probably had some. This is not a normal curve. It changes every year. This was just 2011.
Sure.
We got some rain here in the summer. And so this could have been higher, could have been lower, depending on weather.
But so with our current capability, the county can finish its own water, you know, more than 50% of the time.
Correct.
Based on that graph. And yet,
at what cost?
And yet, right now, the county is required to buy 4 million gallons a day, roughly, whether we need it or not. Is that not correct?
We have a minimum amount in the current contract that we have to purchase.
1.628 billion gallons a year, correct?
Correct.
When in fact, we really only need maybe 800,000 or 800 million, maybe half of that during the summer.
This year wouldn't have been that much. Out in the future, I know, yeah.
And the cost of that water was roughly $3.9 million last year. If we only bought the water that we needed last year during the period where we were above the 14, it would have only cost us around roughly $650,000, if I'm not mistaken. Is that roughly correct?
I didn't do math. I don't know. I mean,
he's probably got it right.
I think it's based on figures that you previously given me that it would have cost us roughly $650,000 for the water that we actually needed to buy last year, which means that the county actually paid the city $3.3 million last year for water that they didn't have to buy.
Just to one point of clarification, I think there's a little difference in the numbers when you look at a peak day. I think the numbers that you may have gotten from me earlier was peak day. This is a 30-day average. So there is some flexibility through storage to bridge around this. So there are different numbers out there depending on which way you want to look at it. If you want to look at a 30-day average or peak day.
I believe the number I was using was when the peak average was above 14 minutes. For that whole month.
It's a lesser number than this, actually.
Correct.
So this shows, this time, this year, it was a little more than that.
Okay. And as far as the permits go, we have a request in for an additional permit of 12 million gallons per day for the new treatment plant. Is that correct?
We got approval. BPD held us up for a long time on building the expansion. And so we got approval to build the new expansion.
Correct.
We'll get approval to operate that, and then our existing plant can run a little over 16 million at a rate of a little over 16 million, but it struggles above 14. When you start backwashing filters, you start having to lose water, and so we'll use the new expansion partially to be more efficient with the water and have less waste, and the new plant's more efficient with the water itself, should be a little more energy efficient. And then we have 20 million gallons of storage. So on those peak days when we need 2 or 3 million gallons, we'll have a little storage there that we can hopefully get that through the next rainfall.
Right.
So after it's finished, I think we've got scheduled for the EPD to come inspect it like they did for the city when they built the new plant up on behind their plant. They gave them approval to operate it, but no additional water. So there will not be additional water right now that goes along with it. We've got permit application in for that to the lake and the river. We've got two applications in the EPD's hand. It's been there for several years. One's for additional water out of the lake and for a partial amount out of the river.
Okay.
If
when you say that we've got a permit to operate, does that mean we don't have an additional permit for finishing water? We're still
correct.
Stuck at the 16?
Yeah, well, no, it's still stuck at 16. Our max day will still be 16.
But we have a request in to increase that?
Requests are in. Those are the ones that are currently being held.
Okay. So if those get approved, then the county would be able to finish up to
28
million gallons per day, correct?
Correct.
More than enough for the county, even on a peak day.
Correct.
So if, and a peak day last year was like 21 million, is that
right? That peak day was, yes, that's right.
So we have a 37 million gallon a day permit for raw water out of the lake.
Well, back here. The combined two.
The shared allocation.
The city's got the biggest half of that permit.
Correct. So if the EPD were to actually allocate that correctly, which the mayor himself admits, the county should get 65% and the city should get 35%. If you allocate that correctly, then the county would be permitted for 24 million gallons a day, 65% of 37 is out to 24 million. Which means that between a reallocation of that permit and the additional permit for the new treatment plant, the county could be 100% independent of the city for treated water.
So,
is that correct?
Think so, but I can't comment on permit shifts. Or
anything's
possible with agreements.
I'm just saying, if those things were happening.
Tim, could you clarify?
Jack.
Go to the mic. No, we can't hear you.
I think Steve's next.
Okay, I'll let you. You've answered.
I was just, if you could.
Jack, just Jack. He's clarifying. I think Steve.
All right, I went to the day and heard the mayor talk, so the answer your question on the 100 million, I believe that's what he's referring to as the new intakes capacity. That's not what is permitted for. That's wonderful, but that doesn't do us any good unless we have that permit. So saying we're getting 65% of 100 million, we can't, 100 million gallons per day, we can't use anyway, is pretty irrelevant. Another thing is, currently we have a CPI built on the contracts with the city and on the raw and finished water. But according to your slides, the actual cost goes down with more gallons that we're using. But we're actually paying more based on inflation. So.
Yeah, my slide was absent of the maintenance of the system cost, so the additional cost could be there. That's our cost.
Sorry, the interruption. Would you clarify the convolution, if you will, the different levels of EPD permitting? Explain to us, and its relationship to Army Corps of Engineers too. There's storage capacity in the lake, and then there's an allocation, and then there's the amount of that allocation that we may process to be finished versus not process and remains raw. And if you can, explain that relationship, because it's
and it is confusing. It gets mixed up a lot of times. And if I mess up, somebody in here can correct me. The Federal Reservoir, there's storage allocation in there. When the lake was divvied out, some of it was for flood control, some of it was for power. And so to get water out of the lake, you're effectively using some of the water that may have been intended for power generation. And so there was a settlement proposed a few years ago where the water providers would actually pay the power company for not having water to turn the turbines. And so there, you've got to have storage allocation, a contract with the Corps of Engineers, and basically they're providing you the bucket. It's still waters of the state. The state can issue the permit that they see fit in the lake or the river. The Corps does not do that. Typically, the Corps wants to see your EPD permit before they're going to give you something. So you can't run down there and say, let me negotiate a permit. They want to see that the state has allocated that water and there's a need because somebody else might need it. And so they require you to have a state permit. But they are separate. What we do not have, never have had, is a storage allocation contract in the lake. The city has one that I showed earlier. It's expired like all the rest of them, because the water wars, the Corps can't renegotiate them. When they do renegotiate it, they've already told us it's going to be at a higher price. So it's not going to be free. They're going to calculate what it would take to build storage, and you're going to have to pay for that water. We don't know how much that's going to be down the road, and that's a bit of a fear. what you're going to pay down the road. So we don't have a federal storage contract. You have to have that to get the water directly from the lake. And as far as the EPD goes, they'll give you withdrawal permits based on need, and then you build a particular facility, and they're going to rate it based on what you've constructed, and you've got operational permits. And those don't always match up with your operational permit. Depends on the type of plant you build and other things. So a lot of times those numbers do get jumbled up, and hopefully I answered that.
So two EPD permits and one Army Corps of Engineer permit.
Correct.
And we have the two EPD permits. One's a shared, the other one's for finished water, but we don't have.
Question was two EPD permits, and we got, yes, we have a withdrawal permit from the EPD, and we have an operational permit to run our facility, and we do not have a storage allocation contract with the Corps of Engineers.
Tim, one quick question. If Hal's math is correct on 24 million max per day, and that's granted us, is there still treated water we need to buy from the city because of piping?
There are still locations where our preference would be to continue to buy. There are the smaller areas out state Route 20. That we don't want to run a second line out there. We've got master meters from the city. So there's some smaller isolated connection spots. I believe we've got 13 or 14 connections, and there would be some water we would, it'd be in our best interest to continue to purchase.
You know how much that is?
It's not a lot. And then you also, you know, this is in a normal month. If we get into an extremely dry period, then we could need more.
Could you clarify the methodology for what you know of it that both the EPD and the Army Corps of Engineers considers? That's my understanding that the way the situation is with storage allocation, which is the most critical component, because that's the bucket you mentioned, and that's what the city has that Forsyth County didn't get 40 years ago, and then the withdrawal permit is our shared allocation. Can you explain the importance of Forsyth County becoming superior versus being subservient in the application for renewal that Cumming is going to have to submit to renew that storage allocation?
I don't know what the time frames are on storage allocation contracts. So I don't know how many years they would look at that. As far as your water permits, EPD permits, everything we do is guided by the Metro District. Several years ago, you know, all the water utilities were fighting with each other for water and wastewater, and so they formed this district. So population projections have been approved, future water needs have been approved for all the Metro District. And so the allocations that the EPD gives is going to be in compliance with those planned facilities unless you modify it. So it's based on expected growth and population projections as far as what the EPD will allocate to both the city and to the county. But I couldn't answer what the Corps. I know our withdrawal permit expires, and they're issued same time ours expires in 2021. And then I've never known the EPD to take away water from a system, but let's say it's possible.
Okay, regardless of the quantity that EPD may grant, the bottom line is the foundation exists with the storage allocation that Army Corps of Engineers grants. Is that correct? In other words, if there's...
I didn't follow that.
What's that?
I didn't follow you. Sorry.
Okay, if the total amount of capacity that is able to be drawn from for the region's stakeholders, that's what... Everything that comes out of the lake, what can come out of the lake and go be distributed in terms of water supply to the municipalities such as Cumming, Forsyth, Atlanta, Roswell, Winnet. If that's a given storage, let's say it's 500 million gallons a day. Okay? Or that's what our demand is. Or let's say that's what they determine, that's what they determine the maximum amount to meet the flow that they need to keep the generators cool and the muscles fresh. So they're gonna have to divide that up amongst the stakeholders.
Correct.
Okay, and the methodology that they will use is based on population demographics. And those population demographics are weighted. In other words, the metric that determines how strong that particular information is based on whether or not that information is subservient to the applicant or superior to the applicant. This is the way that I understood you to kind of explain it in a work session a month and a half ago, where we had to validate our need.
Correct.
Or justify our need, or we didn't get it.
That's correct.
What you said.
We had to prove we needed that water to get the to get as far as we did. We had to show the population projections per capita use. They had to buy into that. They had to verify it from the Metro District. And so.
Is this the EPD or AC?
EPD.
CDD. Okay.
And so we got past that for the draft permit. We had to prove all that before they ever started processing that draft permit for the river. And so that's a process that each applicant goes through. You redo submittals, submit, you know, a lot of documents, and we hire consultants to help justify that need.
In the long, in the big long-term scheme of things, does the water use of Forsyth County as a whole look better with Forsyth County as the superior versus the subservient in that allocation?
We always want to treat our own water and control our own destiny.
Thank you.
I've actually got a question for either Jim or Todd. I understand that you guys met with EPD last week. Are you at liberty to?
Yes.
Or did I miss that?
Let's move on to the meeting. We've got 30 minutes to go.
I'd like to hear what EPD told them about.
I'm going to go into that.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
That's all.
Thank you.
Are there any more questions? You got to come to the microphone.
Jim, I have the same point. We're hearing conjecture. Right. I don't want to hear conjecture, 100 million. I want to hear facts.
Right.
Yep. And I don't want to hear a certain person's agenda. I want to hear facts, not conjecture. So let's
facts. What facts haven't you heard?
What you're about to tell us.
Well, I'm honestly, I'm not sure I follow the question, but I think I had said before that I would talk a little bit about our visit with the EPD. Commissioner Levent and I went down there on Wednesday, and we met with the head of the EPD. Tim Perkins went with us, as did Doug Darrow, the county manager. And we spoke for an hour or so with them, and we brought up the issue that the county had been turned down for our withdrawal from the Chattahoochee River because of the Magnuson case. We pointed out to them that it was, in fact, the EPD itself who declared that Forsyth County is a hardship, not a hardship because of what Magnuson may or may not have meant, but because we were already bumping some of the thresholds of the water that we need. We also, as a group, in a variety of ways, tried to tell them that as a result of that, they also had given what I believe to be our allocation of water, at least some of it, which is supposed to be determined by need. In other words, do you need this water? Not would you like this water? That some of our need was in fact put into the computation for the city of Cumming in order to sell us finished water. And they don't, in my opinion, have necessarily a need to sell us finished water. And my point, and I think Todd's too, was that in a way the EPD has legislatively put us into a position of having to purchase water from one and only one source, and it's sort of a trap we can't get out of. Furthermore, Tim Perkins pointed out, as he said in the slide before, to the EPD, that although their actual order
to the court, this is Judge Magnuson's court, and then back to us, said they would not issue any permits for people who are in our river basin. The fact of the matter is that it appears, and Tim brought up, that they had given Roswell a permit which is in our river basin. EPD initially said that was for a well. Tim challenged them on that, and Tim seems to have been able to determine since then that in fact they both, that Roswell got both a permit for a well and for withdrawal from there. So the main point is that we, right now in terms of allocations, we're trapped by the EPD. Now they offered to look at this. I didn't get a warm fuzzy. When I asked them when they could get back to us, they told me it would take 2 weeks before they could tell me when they could get back to me. And so that's kind of how it goes, and I think that's the tenor of what Tim has been saying about our regulatory agencies as they relate to Forsyth County. Those were those issues. We also brought up with them that in kind of our general opinion, the fact that Forsyth County doesn't have a permit, in other words, a name on an intake, not we have a sort of a logical permit that piggybacks onto the city, but we said there's 170,000 people here who we believe are essentially invisible to you, the EPD and the Corps of Engineers, because you're going to manage lists, names of places that have permits, and you're going to say this area gets X number of gallons in this, and what you're going to see is the city of Cumming, which is roughly 5,000 people. They did not at any point disagree with me on this, but they didn't particularly say, yeah, you're right, we just manage lists, but at no point did they say, don't worry about it, we're going to take care of you.
They did indicate to us that they would actually cater to the thought of adjusting the permits, who gets more, who gets less. But what they did clearly say is they would not at this time look at increasing any permits. And that's when we also brought up the fact that based on the argument that their own department director made, Carol Couch, in the Madison trial, Roswell obtained some permits. But yet they used our county as their argument and we still don't have the permits. So it was interesting, we were fortunate enough, we had some state delegates show up. Mike Dungeon came, Mark Hamilton came, and Senator Murphy were there. But out of the three of them, only one of them looked square in the eye of the director and asked him if you would please work with the county and do everything you can in your power.
Which one?
Mike Dungeon did that, of course. And I don't know where the other two truly stand, they were just very quiet. So I wish they would have spoke up and encouraged. It seems that they can do it for Roswell. I don't understand why they can't do it for us based on the needs that were shown in the court for us. And that's what they went on. But they were not terribly discouraging. I mean, I'm still going to be optimistic. I hope to see what they give us in 2 weeks. I hope that the House, the state delegates do ask them to work with us. It would definitely be in favor of all. If we won't have these, I guess, these negative discussions the city always over this water, I imagine our relationship would be a lot better not only between us and the city, but even amongst commissioners. So it just seems silly that we have all these arguments over this. I mean, it would be very simple. And I do want to clarify something. The 37 million gallons a day is for the city and the county. I know it got a little bit confusing. That's max. It doesn't matter what the city claims their pipe will take in. And they have told me 106 million gallons. However, we don't have an engineer report to substantiate that. And there are some people who think if you got a true engineer report with the turbine spinning, it may only be 80 or 90, but that's irrelevant. Because the fact is, 37 million gallons a day is all the combined permits will allow us to do. Ours 16, theirs is 21, and that's just the way it is. So it doesn't matter if you're buying 66% of that pipe or not, you're still not gonna get your 66% of 106 million like you were asking.
66% of what does come out?
Yeah, of what you can only get with permits allowed to get. It doesn't matter what that pipe is right now. It just doesn't matter. But if there's any other questions, anybody's a little bit not too clear on, that we may be able to help you a little bit to get to a fact.
Did
Did you have any discussions with the EPD about the cost of purchasing raw water from the city?
I'm sorry, say it again.
Did you have any discussions with EPD about the cost of raw, what the city is charging us for raw water?
I explained, and of course, he is asking me if there's any discussion about what the city's charges for the raw water and what they can and can't charge it. And no, they didn't give me a clear answer on that. I know what you're getting at. They did not say that they couldn't charge us anything they wanted to. They didn't want to get into anything that might or may not be a court battle. They didn't want to get any legal advice, I can tell you that. Yeah, past the point. Yes, ma'am.
Todd, I understand that Brian and I believe Pete went down to meet with the EPA also.
You'll have to ask them.
I'd like to know what they told or were told in their meeting.
Almost finished.
I can't speak to what y'all.
That's what I'm saying. I'd like to have Brian
or are you
Pete
finished?
Tell us what they were told or what they
told. He has no microphone.
Might be a little bit more confused now than you were when you got here. And so, well, tonight we're talking about a water contract with the city of Cumming. We've had many water meetings in this room over the years. Tell you what we're not talking about, so we're not talking about a reservoir in Lumpkin County or a reservoir in Dawson County, or the Glades Reservoir. I'll get to it, ma'am. Just let me, if I could. Because we've ruled them out. We've ruled them out. We've spent most of the past year, year and a half, looking at each one of them, and we've ruled them out, and we've come to the conclusion that we're gonna have to do something with water with the city of Cumming. I don't think you hear any board members here tonight saying, we're going to get water out of Glades. So yes, ma'am, I did go to meet with the EPD on Monday, Commissioner Amos and I. I went last year to the EPD. I think that's the third EPD director they've had in 4 years, maybe. EPD serves as the pleasure of the governor. They do not have any, they don't answer to the General Assembly, the legislatures or state senator. However, in our meeting, the legislatures and state senator was in our meeting on Monday, and they were very helpful, all of them. So much so that the director of the EPD encouraged that we negotiate and we have a dialogue with the city coming. Because see, the General Assembly doesn't. And this would be so simple if the General Assembly said, this is how you're going to divide up sales tax, by land mass or by population, but they don't. You're forced to negotiate. We had such a good meeting on Monday that we went back on Tuesday and asked the mayor of the city to come to meet us there, so we could all hear the same thing. With our state legislatures, both of them, two out of three, and our state senator. We're talking about water not only for today, but for the future. If you look up there, yes, you're right. We probably could have produced more of our own water, not have to have bought it from the city of Cumming. But when somebody made that contract 25 years ago, how would they know that?
Brian, did you ask the EPA to increase our permits?
Oh, yeah.
You did?
Sure.
How
There's no doubt, Brian.
Dave, I can even appreciate you being here at all. I can even see that from here. Yeah, 14-day average. This is where we can produce our own water. Everything above that we need from somebody else. Sorry. Everything above that we need from somebody else. We can get a permit today to get water out of Chattahoochee. We can. I mean, that's what the stay is on. 11 million gallons out of the Chattahoochee. So if we get that permit today, you're still 5 years away from treating it properly. We'll pump it 14 miles uphill up Old Land Road to take it to the Antioch water treatment plant. Or you're going to build a plant down on the Chattahoochee, one or the other. It was mentioned earlier that Magnuson's ruling was overturned, and it was. However, that ruling to overturn Magnuson's ruling is on appeal. So we are nowhere near being out of the water wars with Florida and Alabama. And while we can, you know, cite, and I mean, Tim, that was a wonderful presentation, and Tim and his department does a great job. Maybe there was an inconsistency in a huge government bureaucracy that's had three different directors in the past 4 years. That's possible. If they, in fact, gave a surface water permit to, Alpharetta Roswell. But I'm sure that it wasn't 11 million gallons, like we're talking about getting out of Chattahoochee. It was something much, much smaller than that. Right now, Tim made a touched on earlier about we tried to build our own intake on Lake Lanier off Pilgrim Mill Road. I would say to pull 65 million gallons, if we were to, out of that intake, it would probably cost us in the neighborhood of $25 to $30 million. Tim, would you comment?
I believe our estimate was 25 to 30, but it was for like 140. It was big enough for both county and city for redundancy. That was the cost estimate, rough.
Just to throw some point of reference, yes, right now there's a bill, if you will, to pay part of the intake for 11.4 million gallons that could, in the future, provide 65 million gallons a day. Back to the reservoirs, the cheapest price tag on a reservoir is $400 million. That's the cheapest. Then it goes to $600 for the next one, $700 million for the one after that. And at the end of all that, $400 million, $600 million, $700 million, you know what we are at the end of all that? We're a water customer. We don't have the rights to any of the water in any of those reservoirs that people are trying to get us to sign up for.
But we're a customer of Cumming, the city of Cumming.
Sure we are.
So, yeah.
But we don't spend $400 million to be here.
But is it, it has been heard around and said that you and Pete and your crew basically asked the EPD not to work with the county,
well,
and to continue with us having to buy everything from the city of Cumming.
Well, like you started out, it has been said. It is an election year. So I would go ahead and ask you to ask Representative Dudgeon, Representative Hamilton,
oh,
or State Senator Murphy, or the EPD director himself, who was there for the meetings on Monday, and then again on Tuesday.
Can you tell us specifically what changes
the permits
you requested?
We talked particularly about the Chattahoochee, because that is the one that has the stay on it.
We didn't talk about changing the 37 million gallon
allocation
between the city and the county.
Sure we did.
Can you tell us the specifics of what you proposed to the EPD?
We talked about how the permit got to be where it is, and they said, we will talk to you both together. That anything we do for Forsyth County, we're going to do in tandem with the city government.
Well, you didn't say we would like to see 24 million gallons a day for the county, 16 or 14 for the city or whatever. You didn't give them a specific reallocation number that you would like.
We talked about reallocation, and that would have to come with the permission of the city of Cumming. They would have to let some of that go.
Answer my question. Sure. Did you ask for a specific reallocation number from the EDB?
I asked about a reallocation. Whether it's 24 million or 31 million or 17 million, we talked about a reallocation. But to think a reallocation.
In generality, it doesn't really help the county.
Well, sure it does. Well, I mean, when you're having a conversation, with the EPD director about a reallocation, and they say the only way we're going to touch a permit is if the city of Cumming signs off. And what I recommend you do is you have a dialogue and you negotiate with them.
Why would the city have to sign off on the EPD or your allocation? It's the EPD's permit, it's not the city's permit.
Because they said so. They give it out. You're right, you just said it yourself. That's the rules they laid down. It's the EPD's permit. It's not the city's permit, and it's not our permit. Now, is it?
Well, no, it's not.
Well, sorry.
Brian.
We have a new water plant, clean water plant coming online in July. If we get the permit from the EPD to clean more water. And we're currently buying raw water at 10 cents per thousand. What can we clean that water for ourselves?
50, 60 cents.
And we're paying $2.43 right now to the city. We pay that first before we buy clean water from them first. Before we buy or before we do any of our own water?
It's mixed throughout the year. You know, as we go along, we're buying water. Same time, we're treating our own.
When you were down there, Ron, did you ask them to get that permitted? Because obviously that's a huge...
Yes, actually I did.
County. Sure. Why would the city want to sign off on when they're making $2.43 every thousand on the first 4+ million gallons?
Sure.
That doesn't make
His sense. Response was, there's talk down there at the amongst the General Assembly not to let people build plants without permits. That was his response. Because I doubt we're a unique situation. That was his response.
Tim, do we have permits? We got permits to actually build the plant, did we not?
Yeah, we had to get it.
And we're just looking for the final permission to do it, right?
You know, part of the plant, the new expansion can be utilized under existing permit. We can't get all the way up to the full amount. We'll be in position to later, whenever. So
they told, they were quite clear, it was going to be no problem for us to finalize those permits once all the inspections were done. To me, they were quite clear with that.
But no increase in permit. So
you'll be able to finish your 28 million a day, then it'll give you your 14, an additional 14.
If I could store enough water somewhere else, I could treat the full amount, you know, using that facility.
Correct. But they're not going to hold out on that plan. I mean, we've got our correct permits in time.
They have it for others. I mean, there's no reason for it to. They just care how much water you withdraw. They don't care how much you use of the plant for redundancy or anything else. So they typically let counties overbuild infrastructure. Okay, so this last year we had a filter blowout. We lost 25% of the plant. So they look at it that way. The extra plant capacity, is just that. It's redundancy and backup for emergencies. But they, you know, they made it real clear, you know, unless something is worked out with permits, we can't treat more than what we have.
I'm going to make something else. I know it's been brought up that if we could get the 11 or possibly 12 million gallons a day of the river, that long pipe is going to cost us a lot of money. And Tim showed a chart that you couldn't see a little while ago, but it was showing in 20 years if we could deal with our unfinished water, that's a savings of $103 million.
$4 million.
and it's approximately $19 million, if I'm correct, to run that pipe from the river. Doesn't take long to recover your money back, if that's correct. So, $19 million on a pipe from the river.
The estimate for that was $19 million.
So it still seems a feasible way to go. Even if we got them out of the river, $19 million seems cheap out of $103 million savings.
Yes, but how long would it take to do that?
So you do a temp, you do a shorter term permit, so that's all.
Sure.
You get some realistic numbers, and then you go with it that way. You just don't automatically sign the dotted
line. I think that's a great idea. I think if we can get a five-year extension on the finished contract,
we don't need finished water from the city for 5 years, though. Why would we get an extension?
We don't.
Sure we do.
But we cannot finish more than 14 million gallons at our current plant.
Correct.
And we built this plant at risk. The state says that, and they're going to put a stop to it. Let me finish. Okay. I know last year we didn't use as much water. But some years we do, months we depend on the city. We piggyback the city.
And we buy it.
And we buy finished water from them.
But we buy it as we need.
But this was a 25-year contract. We haven't even made an offer to the city yet for a new contract. Remember, this county didn't have a contract, or a water plant, when it did this contract. So this is 25 years old, so we keep talking about this contract. It's up. It's time to do a new contract.
But you're talking about extending it.
How is it extended?
That's what Brian just said. We extend this contract.
Sure, I said short term on the finished water. If we don't have a permit, we don't need it, because yes, we do if we don't have a permit to finish our water.
If we can only finish 14 million and make 20 million one day, who are we going to get it out?
You're going to buy it from the city when you need it. But you're not going to extend the contract that says you have to buy $4 million a day.
Well, I would tell you, don't need the one thing.
I never said 4 million gallons a day.
No.
You said extend the existing contract. The existing contract says you have to buy 4 million a day on average.
Price and quantity. Be negotiated. You need to buy finished water from that.
That's not an extension. That's a renegotiation. You said extend existing contract.
Thank you, Hal. I mean, renegotiation. How's that?
That's fine. If you're talking about renegotiating,
okay. Then I'll say one thing about buying water when you need it from the city of Cumming.
Please go to the microphone.
Okay. One thing about buying water from the city of Cumming when you need it. Oh, well, probably more than one thing. First of all, it's not sitting on the shelf. It has to be produced. Okay? And this water, costs more money to finish than this one. Historically, traditionally, when the lake is lower, there's more sediment per gallon. What's that have to do with what?
The man. You said when the lake is down. The man, when the lake is up or down.
That's right. But the cost to finish the water when the lake is down can be more than the cost to finish the water when the lake is up. So if you buy it when you need it, are you going to buy it at market price? Because right now we can buy it at Gwinnett for, what,
$3.03?
$3.03 a gallon. We can buy it from Gwinnett at $3.03 and get out of the $2.42. Do you support that?
The point is, you don't need to buy water between October and April, ever. So why would you?
Now.
That's correct.
Okay. 5 years from now.
5 years from now, hopefully we're going to have
hopefully?
So you write a contract that says we're going to buy so much for the next 5 years, we have an option to extend that for another 5 years. If we need it, if we don't, we get out.
Okay. It's
time to renegotiate. Said 5 years,
didn't I? Okay, well, I've been hearing you can extend the existing contract.
You have never heard me say extend finished water for 25 years.
Yeah, I actually did hear you say that in working on this.
25 years.
Well, I don't know about 25 years. You said extend the, you made a motion finished to extend water. The existing contract.
I'd like to say one thing. Everybody keeps asking about the EPD. Mr. Turner stood there and he said, this water is like a ladder. He said, we've got numerous rungs to climb up. And the closer we get to the top, we're going to get to the top one day, and then we're going to have to deal with the Endangered Species Act. So, you know, it was all a roundabout. You know, one day we're going to get all this finished and then we'll look at permits, but that's one day, I don't know when. And it's like, we've got to go through all this legal hurdle, get to the top, and we start more legal hurdles. As we said in the paper that came out earlier this week, Georgia spent $18 million in the last few years fighting this thing, but Alabama hadn't got the courts yet. They just filed the papers right now. So we're just stuck in the middle of this water war. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. Wouldn't it have seemed better and have worked out better if you two had decided to work with Jim and Todd and going down there together, putting up a united front? Did you represent the city of Cumming or the county of Forsyth? And your
you all both had relations with the city,
right?
Yes.
Right.
To me, it's a conflict of interest that you're even dealing with the city. Yeah. Yeah. One has a restaurant, the other has a restaurant.
Let me make sure a question about.
I would just like
to. Let me make sure a question first. Commissioner Levent and Commissioner Boff did not ask us to go with Mr. Murphy. Asked us if we'd like to come down after. We had no idea until Saturday before the meeting.
And you're not mad enough to say, hey, Jim, hey, Todd.
You never told us.
I didn't know. I didn't know they were going.
You never told those guys you were going. You were the commission. You never told them until you got back.
Tell
that's really good. That's really good. First thing you've got to learn to do is communicate with your boss.
They didn't tell us?
Not
they
with the mayor.
We would
communicate with the mayor, talk to the men on the board.
They didn't ask us to go with them.
Well, no, why'd you ask them?
What was the first step? No, I didn't ask the mayor.
That's what I was told.
Mr. Turner. Because Mr. Turner asked the mayor. But
one of our state delegation called the mayor and asked him to meet us there.
Yes.
Do you think
you one last you thing, do, one last thing.
I'll
just
say one thing up and sit here for an hour and 31 minutes like everybody else. And I think that you and Bobby Amos should recuse yourself in these negotiations.
Okay. Well, you're entitled to your opinion, and I'll just refer you to my voting record for 8 years.
I'm good. Well, I just, you know.
Voting record is what it
is. People are wary of politicians that you don't know. And no matter what level.
Josh is the mayor's transit,
right? Yeah, right. And you're in, you know, with your restaurant to that the mayor owns and whatever, you know, you can't say no to them. So, and like you mentioned, as far as Amos' family, they own, you know, Boo's the property in the county, so it's understandable why you would be sticking up close to the city.
Okay, I've got a few things to say. My name is Jim Boff.
Not hair.
Jim Boff. My fingerprints obviously are all over these contracts, and we've dealt with this probably since first time I got involved in it was 86, and I lived in Deerwood subdivision at the time, and the city was talking about putting their intake in our rec department lot on the lake. So I became involved with it then. I'd also done some work in Tacoma with some of my friends over there when they tapped into the last Georgia Power Dam on the Savannah, before it became the Savannah River, and pulled water out of that. So I was aware of that. Won't take a lot of time. The contract that we negotiated in 1997, you cannot extend it because we increased the tap-on fees to $1,500 a water meter. And that's with 3,000 new water meters a year. Our growth is plummeting, and there's no viable way that the contract can be extended without those type of tap-on fees. Since we're not getting that type of revenue, and you start multiplying 3,000 by 1,500, you see the amount of revenue that generates, and it increased up to about 6,000 4 or 5 years ago before the decline in the housing market. That's not a viable option to extend the contract as it's written. And we wrote it, and we would have extended it further with some stipulations. Everything that was done prior to me taking office in January of 97. Even though you see contracts in 97, you see contracts in 98, 99, and 2000, this whole thing was done prior to January the 1st of 97. We knew we were going to increase the rates on the new water meters. That was a given. It was just when we could do it, when we had to do it.
when you were going to piggyback their intake and put them on the spot with that. Ken Hall did that. That was done ahead of me taking office. We met with Harold Rehise on this, many different meetings, so it was all set and done, even though it didn't take place for 2 and 3 years after that. What you all need to do is be thankful that you have somebody like Tim Boff and Todd Levent that will come up here and explain things. No, the mayor's not an evil person. I've known somebody like the mayor ever since, in fact, one of our football players reminds me so much of him. He has a point of view, but in private, he's a very reasonable, honest person. Now, when you get into a situation like this, it's going to be confrontational, and nobody can be any more confrontational than I am. And I've got the broken fingers and the cracked teeth to prove it. Being a hothead doesn't help. And that's why, here again, with Jim and Todd, you've got somebody that's not a hothead. You've got somebody that will take the time to explain and have a public hearing like this for everybody to participate and get involved with what's going on. You need to sit down, and I'm sure they'll do that, and they'll negotiate off of the contract that we did. You cannot repeat what was done in 87 and what we extended and added to in 97, 98, and 99. That just won't work because of the growth and the way it's died. Now, I've said what I wanted to say, so, and I know he wants to get home because he's hungry, and Charlie Smith's hungry too. So I'm going to sit down. We've all learned a lot, and I'll turn this over and let him finish. Chairman Boff.
Sometimes I get called names as a commissioner, and sometimes I get mail sent to me as honorable. Neither one do I deserve. And, thank you. I don't deserve that either. Thank you. Anyway, Todd, do you have anything you want to say?
I just wanted to say thank you for everybody for coming. I got to tell you, I wish more people were involved. I'm sorry it got a little confrontational. That was not my plans tonight, but certainly I hope everybody was educated some. And please do share this information with your neighbors. It can only help. Thank you.
I said that I would tell you about my meeting with the mayor. We're past 7:35.
That's fine.
Would you like, okay, I'll make it quickly. We met at the Atlanta Bread Company. It was a very cordial meeting, although we talked fairly directly, talked for about an hour. And just from memory, bottom lining kind of points that were made at that time to me by the mayor. I'm not saying that he said, if I don't get this, you know, bad things are going to happen. He just said, this is how he saw it. And so what he told me then is that he feels that the county owes him the $11 million or the 65% of the $17 million that he spent on the intake. Myself and our legal staff disagree that we have a legal obligation to pay that. I also feel, however, that possibly for ownership, actually the ability to say we own, the county owns 65% or some percentage of that, and some percentage of the easement into the lake, is a very reasonable thing to talk about. The other thing that he said is that, by and large, he didn't care whether we took any finished water or not. We could take some or not take it. He wasn't saying we necessarily did, but that he would go up on the raw water. And I asked him for any kind of a representative number, and the nominal number he threw out was $1 a thousand, which is 10 times the roughly 10 cents we pay now. And he also said that he didn't see why we would ever get ownership of the intake. But that's pretty much our conversation in a nutshell.
Mr. Chairman, when can we expect the board to come to some agreement among themselves and put a proposal out for the people of Forsyth to have some idea where you're going?
OK. Okay, well, first of all, 2 years ago, there were two proposals sent to the city. And to the best of my knowledge, we never heard back from the city about those proposals. That's not answering your question, however. I had a proposal that I did a couple weeks ago. Todd has done a proposal. Tea Party has had a meeting, and they have a proposal. The issue is getting all the commissioners to come up and say, let's send this one across the street and see what happens. Frankly, I don't know the answer to your question. We're having a meeting April the 5th with a public hearing regarding water. That may be the night that something is
sent across. Could we publish those three proposals someplace where people could look at them?
I don't see why not, but I'm going to have to check exactly how to do that, whether it's on the website or sent out as an open record or some other thing. But they're not available on the website, to my knowledge, at the time.
Jim, isn't the April 5th public hearing, if I recall correctly, is that not to on a motion to extend the existing contract until October of this year? Is that not what that public hearing is about?
That is specific. Well, that is what the agenda item is. The public hearing, I think, can be pretty flexible on almost anything.
That was the motion that was made.
That's from memory, yes, that's right.
It was a vote it was a 3-2 vote for the contract to be extended to October 31st. And because of the new rules of the board, it didn't have the 4/5 it needed for an intergovernmental agreement.
Right.
So now it goes to a public hearing, which that will be it. And then the three commissioners that voted for the time, if they choose to vote for it again, can send that over as an offer, which is to extend the existing contract to October 31st.
Dave?
Jim, why can't the board change the date instead and vote to extend that contract until July of next year? This way you get rid of any of the political ramifications of commissioners running for re-election, any lame duck commissioners who might be voted out of office come July of this year, from voting on something that they're not going to be responsible for any longer. Why the October date? Why can't you push that until next year?
If I may, Jim. I heard a lot of verbiage that day in the meeting from the commissioners who voted on it. They wanted to align it with the lost negotiations. However, your point's pretty well made, because I understand there's going to be some more reports finalized on true needs and how to assess those needs before municipalities. The first report's going to come out this June, July, but the final stuff's supposed to come out in June, July of 13. And I understand your dates. However, you might need an additional 3 months for us to actually come to an agreement to get back and forth with the city respectfully to come up with an agreement. But you're right, if that comes out and shows needs and helps our cause, it will definitely give us a little bit of leg up on negotiating, there's no doubt.
Just a response to Dave, my objection to that idea is that it would cost the county another $4 million over that 1 year, 1.3 or 1 year and 3 months that we are going to be forced to buy fish water that we don't need. So there is a $4 million price tag to extending it to July of next year.
But you have the commissioners voting on it. That's what I'm saying.
I understand there's upside and downside. I totally agree with you. I would like to ask, when you were discussing the invoice that the mayor gave you, did you ask him why it took him 2 years to send an invoice for work that was done 2 years ago, and he waited until, you know, less than 4 months before the water contract expired?
I did not ask him that.
Is there some relationship to the loss service delivery negotiations that occur in October, and any benefit or otherwise of having that occur at the same time?
Well, there is a relationship. You know, the service delivery. Service delivery is the services that the city will provide, and the area that they'll provide it in, and the services that the county will provide, and sometimes they're overlap. Obviously, the city has a water service area that where they provide water and sewer, in some cases outside the city limits of Cumming. So, you know, I don't want to speculate on what might happen, but supposing the service area changed, supposing we decided that the city should take more, and this is just an example of the area of the county, that would justify potentially them, you know, having to change the allocation or some piece of the formula of the water that they get, because now they're going to have a larger area. There's one other thing that hasn't been brought up here that I won't dwell on, but I do want to bring up, and that is that every county government is qualified. Qualified has to do with being approved by DCA and the state of Georgia. You can lose your qualification. Qualifications provide people with the ability to take out GFA loans and a long list of other things. It is, I think it was Gwinnett lost their accreditation a little while back that got it back. If we do not have, if we were to just say we're not doing anything with this water contract, it is conceivable that we could lose our accreditation. It's my understanding if we lose our accreditation, we then cannot negotiate a loss, and that would be a lot of revenue. I did not say that there isn't some kind of thing legally we could write to the state explaining that we're in some sort of situation with the water, but this stuff, like it or not, is all bound up together. And that's something you should know because it could affect the county. Tony?
Jim, Dave's suggestion, plus adding a few months that Todd added, seems to make sense for standpoint is it totally separates water from loss. It seems to me that could be a good thing.
And I don't necessarily disagree. It's certainly something to consider. Other people on the board initially talked about the possibility of an extension or some kind of thing like that.
Yeah, and just one other thing. I appreciate Cal wanting to save that for them.
Right.
But the fact is we're not going to walk away from the city and cut them totally dry, okay? Let's be realistic, okay? We're going to gradually phase out of the $10 or $12 million every year we've been giving them extra, okay? Because it is $10 to $12 million of extra revenue that you're getting from the county, SPLOS, lost, and water.
Mr. Chairman, if I understand the lost laws correctly, the board actually has to take action to renew it.
Yes.
So has that been done yet?
Yes, there are steps, and we have started those actions to renew them.
So the board has voted to renew LOST?
No. My understanding is we have to inform the city and begin the process of working on the LOST, and we have done that.
Well, then my question is, with the motion to combine the LOST and the water contracts, since the LOST process hasn't started, how do you combine those two? LOST doesn't exist, that LOST process doesn't exist yet, there's no action taken on it. How can the motion be to combine water and LOST when you haven't decided whether you're going to do LOST?
I don't know there was a motion to combine them. There's a relationship between the two. Okay. And
I thought the motion was to combine them.
I'm not aware of that. Somebody else.
I have to read the motion. Okay. Yeah. I can look at the motion.
The issue was just that there is a relationship between the two, and shouldn't we get all that sorted out before we do just the water contract? Hal?
I would just like to make a comment about loss and I just want to make a comment about combining loss and the water contract. The loss is based on the service delivery strategy, and the service delivery strategy currently includes delivery of water to the county. However, if we have a water contract and the city charges the customers for water, why would we also include some percentage of lost to pay for water? We're already paying for water. We're paying $2.43 in the county for water. The mayor is charging a city rate to the city customers, and then he's charging an upgraded rate to an extended city area, and then he's charging an even larger rate to all of the county residents. So we are paying for water. There is no reason for the service delivery strategy and the loss split to include anything to do with water whatsoever. It's already paid for.
One last question. Yes, sir.
Okay. When you're negotiating for the new contract with the city, we've heard different numbers thrown around, 5 years, 10, 25 years. What is your target as far as the length of time to get a new contract with the city? Do you have one?
I personally do not have a target. There are so many variables here. I don't know if we had to pay a lot of money up front. If we pay for the intake, then I would want a long one, assuming that that allows us to pay less per gallon or per 1,000 gallon. If we don't pay up front, I think a shorter one. But it's unfortunately, this whole thing is, to my mind, as complex as anything I've ever tried to work with before, and I freely admit that. I'm just looking for something that could turn out to be workable for both sides and fair to both sides, I think.
The 11.4 million for the intake, I cannot even grasp. I can grasp paying it. What I can't grasp is paying it and not have ownership in it. You got to show them what. Honestly, if we could get past that one hurdle, I think the rest of it would fall into place a lot easier. That's a very hard hurdle to get over. I don't think anybody in their right mind would pay that kind of money for anything without partial ownership.
How many more people have a question to ask? Is it okay if this is, I said you'll be the last one, but one more, Steve.
If we're buying raw water for 10 cents and we're sharing in the operational power cost of transporting free water that's coming out of the lake.
That is the sharing cost.
Right.
Yeah, okay. The 10 cents is the shared cost. It's not 10 cents plus shared cost. That's the average for the last few months.
And the Corps only charges $200,000 to pull it from the lake. Is that correct?
I don't believe that was ever implemented. We pay a lot less. We pay $13 and something per million gallons.
Why would the mayor want to charge? How could he possibly expect to really reasonably charge a dollar, 1,000% increase on something that he's getting
for free?
Finished water, I understand. Finished water, you're doing something to me, but raw water is raw water.
Chairman, may I say one thing to put that dollar per 1,000 gallons in context? I'm Gene Holmes, and I live in Forsyth County, and I've been pushing for several years this Tennessee River water pipeline idea. In the governor's 2009 Water Contingency Task Force report, a dollar per 1,000 gallons is what Brown and Caldwell said it would take to get water here from the Tennessee River, partially treated to remove invasive species. So to give you an idea, a dollar per 1,000 gallons for raw water out of Lakeland here, that's a little bit high. You can get water from the Tennessee River.
One thing that's subject to change here is the Army Corps of Engineers is reevaluating that storage capacity, and they're also reevaluating the methodology that's going to be applied. And that includes the amount that they charge the municipalities that they've granted a right to take that storage allocation. So the fact that it's maybe free today and has been for the last 30 or 40 years is subject to change in the next 12 months. So we can't just assume that may be something, maybe the mayor knows something we don't. Maybe it's going to cost him 90 cents too. So to be fair.
Okay, thank you everybody. Thank you very much for coming. I hope you learned something.
Hang on, let me get a feel real quick for one thing. The 6 month renewal, a 12 month renewal, or an 18 month till all reports come in. 18 month, how many year thing as is 18 months till we get our needs reports in? to negotiate. Anybody here on with that? Because you've got to give us some kind of insight to what you would like to see us do on the 4th. Otherwise, we're guessing, and then we get our emails afterwards. All right, thank you.